Okay, this is the first in a series of lectures that I'm going to be giving on the COVID pandemic. So this is how I think the sessions are going to go. I've got five sessions planned covering these general topics, and if there are any specific bespoke topics that you want covering, just let me know. We're going to start off with what is COVID-19 as a disease and what is the SARS-CoV-2 virus. We're going to look at how the virus replicates in host cells, and we're going to look at the viral life cycle. So we're going to introduce a little bit of basic cell biology, and you'll get much more detailed cell biology and virology in your CBBM lectures and elsewhere on your course. We're then going to move on to looking at how the virus spreads. So how does it spread from person to person? There's a lot of controversy about this at the moment, but we're going to look at different routes of viral spread in general, and particularly this virus. We're going to look at what protection can be in place, so different PPE, what they mean, what they protect you from, what they don't protect you from. And we're also going to look at the concept of super spreading events, which we know are a major problem with this particular virus. Okay, we're then going to move on to some mathematical predictions of what might happen. So although it sounds like quite scary, the mathematics behind predicting epidemics is surprisingly simple and surprisingly predictable. We're not going to go into too much detail on this, but we're going to look at things like doubling time. So you'll be hearing in the news that the virus has increased. Doubling time is 10 days, doubling time is 3 days. It certainly was in March. So we'll be looking at these concepts and seeing what it could mean for the future, and be looking back over data from the first wave and seeing what we can learn from that. We'll also be looking at weaknesses in the data and some very major public misconceptions of data, such as what is today's case rate and how does that relate back to what happened in the first wave. We're then going to move on to the molecular testing that is done to detect the virus. Now, we do the testing by quantitative PCR. I will just introduce the basics of PCR. qPCR is a later topic on your course. But we're going to look at the concept of detecting the genetic material of the virus by PCR, polymerase chain reaction, and comparing that to antigen-based tests, which is detecting viral protein, versus antibody testing, which is detecting people who have developed antibodies to the virus as a result of being infected with it. So we're going to look at the theory of how these tests work and what they show. And then finally, we're going to move on to the sensitivity and specificity of these tests. Sensitivity, obviously, is how sensitive the test is, what proportion of the population with the virus are detected. Specificity relates to the possibility of false positives. And we're going to look at some real controversies that have been in the media about the sensitivity and the specificity of both the PCR test and the antigen and antibody tests, because they have very different sensitivities and specificities. Now, also in this session, we're going to cover some controversies, if we have time for that. Controversies might be where the virus comes from in the first place, the controversies over whether or not we should have been wearing face masks from the start, this type of thing. So anything that you think might be interesting to add to this lecture series, let me know and I'll write that into one of the lectures for you. So first, let's introduce the virus. So the virus is the SARS-CoV-2 virus. SARS stands for Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2. And this is because there was a previous SARS version called SARS in the early 2000s. So the virus is called SARS-CoV-2. Now, there's been previous coronavirus infections related to SARS-CoV-2. And those are, as I mentioned, SARS and MERS, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. So for a nice little introduction for you, it's well worth clicking on this link that's present in the PowerPoint version of the slides. Click on that, read that article. I know it's called Everything You Need to Know About COVID-19. It's not quite everything you need to know, but it is a really nice, accessible introduction. So read that and then move on. So firstly, to understand how viruses act upon cells, we need to understand a little bit of very basic cell biology, and you'll be covering this in your CVBM module or elsewhere on your course. But basically, I'm just reminding you that cells are made up of a membrane, surrounded by a membrane made up of a phospholipid bilayer. So this is the outside of a cell. It's a phospholipid bilayer. And you can see in more detail there. Here's the outside of the cell. Here's the inside of the cell. And we have these two layers of phospholipids, which make up the plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is complicated. It has various membrane proteins within it. So here you can see the red phospholipid heads of the plasma membrane, and spanning the membrane are membrane-associated proteins. Some of these are on the outside. Some of these have got little carbohydrate chains and other chains on them. Some of the proteins will spiral through the plasma membrane. Others will form channels. Others will be receptors on the outside of the cell. Now, this is important because when we move on to the viral life cycle, the importance of membrane proteins will become clear. So this plasma membrane is surrounding the cell, and then within the cell we have the cytoplasm. We have all of our organelles within that cytoplasm. So here you can see a different shaped cell. So this is an epithelial cell lining the gastrointestinal tract. But the plasma membrane runs around the outside and in all of these little projections here. And then within the cell, you've got all of your organelles, you've got your mitochondria, you've got your endoplasmic reticulum, you've got your Golgi apparatus, which you are going to cover in the functions of that in other modules. And importantly, here you have your nucleus, and your nucleus is where the genetic material of the cell is kept. And for cells, obviously, for eukaryotic cells, we're talking about DNA. Now, this is a slide which explains how that DNA relates to protein production. So within our cells, the genome is DNA, and this is present in the nucleus. The genome, the DNA, we call it the genome, the whole DNA within the cell, contains instructions for the cell to produce proteins. And to cut a very long story very short, and you'll get a much longer version of this story in other modules, here is the DNA. It's a region of that DNA where there is a gene. That gene, an RNA copy, which is a ribonucleic acid copy of that gene, is produced in the nucleus. That RNA copy, we call it a messenger RNA, is exported out of the nucleus. This ends up in the cytoplasm and links up with a ribosome, which will translate that mRNA sequence into a protein sequence. Now, you'll cover this in great detail in CVBM, but this is an overview of the system because we need to understand this system to see how gene structure and gene function in eukaryotic cells differs from the virus that we are about to study. So, to summarise, DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, a region of DNA, we'll call it a gene, allows an mRNA to be produced. That mRNA is exported out of the cell. That mRNA links up with a ribosome, and that ribosome reads that mRNA to produce a protein chain made out of amino acids. Okay, so the reason I was labouring that point is it's really important to understand the viral life cycle. So we're going to now cover what are viruses. So viruses are these subcellular sized infectious particles. They are much smaller than a cell. They're tiny. The important thing about them is this phospholipid bilayer, which is on the outside of the virus. And this phospholipid bilayer is just like the phospholipid bilayer of a human cell. Now, this is the important thing about the viruses. They can have a genome, which is either DNA or RNA. So some have a DNA genome. They get into cells, they release that DNA is transcribed into RNA, and that RNA produces transducers as codes for proteins. Other viruses have an RNA genome. They don't have any DNA in them whatsoever. And the SARS-CoV-2 virus is an RNA virus. So here is the genome. So this is RNA genome. It's got various proteins stuck to the RNA to make it more stable. And then the other key features of the virus that are really important that we're going to talk about extensively are these proteins on the outside of the virus. And one of the most important ones that we're going to discuss is the spike protein, which is important for getting the virus into the host cells. So if you remember back, the our own cells have proteins on the outside of them, membrane proteins. Well, our membrane proteins are going to interact with these spike proteins, and that is going to allow the virus to trick our cells into allowing it to gain entry into our own cells. Now, if you want a fairly in-depth read on SARS-like coronaviruses, you can click on this link here on the PowerPoint version of the slides, and that will take you to an article which summarizes these viruses. It might be quite heavy going initially, but if you come back to it later on in the course when you've learned a little bit more, it will be much more accessible then. Okay, so this slide shows a little bit about how viruses enter cells, and this is not SARS-CoV-2, this is influenza. So here you can see, here's the virus, it's got a phospholipid bilayer, it's got various proteins on the outside of the virus particle. It gets into our respiratory tract. One of these proteins on the surface of the virus interacts with a protein on the surface of our host cells, and that encourages the virus particle to be engulfed in a little vesicle. It's taken up into the cell. The virus then instructs the vesicle to break down. We call that uncoating. That will allow the viral RNA to be released. That will allow the viral RNA genome of the virus to be replicated, which is crucial for viral replication. And messenger RNAs are produced. They can be exported to the cytoplasm. That will result in protein synthesis of the viral proteins, and the viral RNA can be produced, and then we get assembly of viral proteins on our own host cell plasma membranes. So the viral proteins are exposed on the outside of the plasma membrane. The genome, the viral RNA, will congregate in the same place, and then we will get budding off of our own plasma membranes from our own lung lining cells, and that will bud off millions of new virus particles. Okay, so we're not dealing with influenza. Influenza is a very nasty virus. We're dealing with coronaviruses, a different family of viruses. And these coronaviruses are so called because under an electron microscope, which is an incredibly powerful microscope that uses electrons instead of light photons to look at objects, you can see the viral particles there. These are tiny, tiny things, but on the outside you see this corona, and corona refers to the word crown, so it's crown-like structures sticking out, and some of these are the spike proteins that I mentioned earlier. So these are the spike proteins. So down the electron microscope you can see this almost halo-y set of little bits of protein sticking out. So that's why the family of viruses are called coronaviruses. So we look at the basic anatomy of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, and we'll start to link it into its life cycle. We have a phospholipid bilayer, just like from a eukaryotic cell, because that's where it came from in the first place. It budded off from a eukaryotic cell. We have the spike protein sticking out, and those are going to be crucial for linking into human cells to gain access. So this protein links with a very specific human protein, which we'll cover fairly shortly. And then within the virus particle, we have the RNA genome, and this codes for all of the proteins that the SARS-CoV-2 virus requires for its replication cycle. Okay, so I've mentioned briefly SARS, MERS, and SARS, I've extensively mentioned SARS-CoV-2. SARS was a severe acute respiratory syndrome, which spread around a large number of countries in 2003. Started off in a very similar way to the current COVID-19 pandemic. Later on, MERS, Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, arose, and this is a disease that is very, very severe and very lethal. These are very closely related to the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So, don't worry about this up here. Coronaviruses are one group. There are lots of different families of viruses. We're only really going to deal with the coronavirus as a small family of viruses. And there are alpha, beta, gamma, delta coronaviruses. We're not even going to mention these. We're interested in these beta coronaviruses. And SARS itself, MERS, and SARS-CoV-2 are beta coronaviruses. And all of these can infect humans. There are other coronaviruses which are much less lethal, shall we say, less pathogenic. They cause things that we think are like our common cold. Lots and lots of viruses cause symptoms of the common cold. And some of these coronaviruses can cause common cold type symptoms. There are others like rhinovirus, which also cause common cold. So common cold is not a single virus. There are lots of viruses that cause cold-like diseases. So the SARS and SARS-CoV-2 share lots of similarities with a recently identified bat coronavirus, suggesting that that is the genetic origin of the virus. We know bats are infected with coronaviruses, and the sequence of the virus that is infecting humans at the moment is very similar, not identical, but very similar to this bat virus. Now, what happened in the SARS pandemic of 2002-2003 is that this virus seemed to jump to this civet cat, almost like raccoon type thing. And this virus got into these animals, gained the ability to infect these animals, and then subsequently were able to infect humans. How this jump happened was not entirely clear. Similarly, but more distantly related, is the MERS virus, and this is again a different bat coronavirus that has infected camels and then infected camel herders in the Middle East. And this virus was really very, very unpleasant, killing up to 30% of the people who got infected with it, because the people who were handling the camels then were infected with MERS. And then a bat virus, possibly similar to the one that infected these civet cats and caused the SARS pandemic 2003, has infected, we think, possibly, most likely, the pangolin. And quite possibly pangolins that have been imported into the country, but this is, at the moment, unclear. So we think that the very similar virus that infected this group of organisms has now infected pangolins and then once again jumped to being able to infect humans. So the question is whether this bat virus could infect humans directly by handling them, or whether it has managed to infect the pangolin and then once it's managed to grow effectively in pangolins, has managed to then be able to jump to humans. There's a lot of question marks about this route and how it happened. Now, one of the important things to mention here, as I briefly mentioned, MERS, highly lethal. About a third of patients who caught it died, but it was not very infectious. SARS, highly lethal. About 10% of people who caught it died, but again, it was not particularly infectious. SARS-CoV-2, much, much more infectious, much more difficult to control, but thankfully not as lethal. And this is shown here. This is a plot from the World Health Organization, although I have edited it for what we think about more recent data that's come out since this plot was produced. And it shows different viruses with different levels of deadliness. And MERS here, incredibly lethal, however, not very contagious. So here is a scale that we're going to talk about later on in this lecture series called the R0 value. And the R0 really refers to how many people an infected person is likely to infect. And we think that under normal situations, the SARS-CoV-2 is about here, whereas MERS was way down here. SARS, if uncontrolled, could be more contagious, but there were things to do with SARS that allowed us to control the spread, and that was that people tended to have a really high temperature before they were infectious. So if you have people who were infected with SARS and let them go about the business, they would spread the virus very, very widely. However, and this was particularly important for airports and that virus getting around the world, people were screened for, whenever there's an outbreak, people were screened for their temperature, and if their temperature was high, they were isolated, and that allowed us to bring the R value down so that SARS, although it had the potential to be highly infectious, it was controllable because we had this classic symptom of a very high temperature before the patients were infectious. SARS-CoV-2, unfortunately, is just as contagious in an uncontrolled setting, and lots of people are asymptomatic, as we know. So SARS, in the initial SARS outbreak, was contained. The current one has not been very well contained, as you all well know. Okay, this is where the lecture is going to get quite tricky, and we're going to look at some concepts which at this stage in the course will be difficult, but I'll try to explain it as clearly as I can. All three viruses have got an RNA genome, as I mentioned. Now that genome is approximately 30,000 bases or 30,000 nucleotides in length. Now you compare that to the human genome, which is 3 billion bases or nucleotides in length. This is a relatively small piece of RNA, and a typical gene on the human genome might span 50 to 100,000 nucleotides, and that is, you know, a size of a fairly average sized gene. So this entire genome is smaller than an average human coding gene. The SARS viruses code for several what we call open reading frames. So the virus is RNA, and we know that messenger RNA is RNA. What these open reading frames are regions of that genome that can link up with a ribosome and be translated into protein. So basically you've got one long strand of RNA that is effectively like being made up into these 10 different genes or regions which code for different proteins. So as you can see, the general structure of the virus genome is very, very similar across all of these three viruses, confirming the similar likely origin of them. It's just that as the three different viruses have evolved or derived from different species of different types of bat virus, they're all subtly different. These genes are, or these open reading frame protein coding regions of RNA, are subtly rearranged between each one, which allows us to do simple genetic tests to tell the difference between all of these different viruses. So we've got lots of open reading frames, 1A, 1B, and so on, which code for different important proteins for the virus. But then we get onto this S open reading frame, which is the codes for the spike protein, which is the genetic information in the virus, which allows the virus to produce, or it allows the virus to instruct our host cells to produce spike protein. So that gene is very similar between SARS, MERS, and the virus that causes COVID-19. However, these spike proteins interact with different proteins. So both SARS and SARS-CoV-2 can both interact with a protein called ACE2 on human cells, which we'll come to shortly. MERS uses a completely different one. So as you can see, they are all very, very similar viruses, very similar genetic structure, very closely related, because they all derive from a very similar type of bat coronavirus. So putting together everything that I've just covered, here is the SARS-CoV-2 life cycle. So here's the virus. It attaches to our lining cells of our respiratory tract, and we also now know it can infect lots of other cells, including the gastrointestinal tract, and muscle and fat cells and lots of others, but let's just focus on the respiratory side of things. There is a protein expressed on some of those respiratory cells called ACE2. Doesn't really matter what it is, it's called angiotensin converting enzyme 2, but it's a minor detail. It's a protein that's expressed on some of our cells. So the spike protein for SARS-CoV-2 recognizes the ACE2 receptor on the surface of our cells. That encourages the virus to be engulfed into the cell. And then once the virus is engulfed in the cell, we get uncoating of that phospholipid bilayer, releasing the genetic information, which is ribonucleic acid, or RNA. That RNA comes into contact with ribosomes, and those ribosomes will read the RNA and produce proteins for each of those open reading frames. Now, open reading frames are something you'll cover extensively in CBBM. That's your other cell biology module. Okay, so the RNAs come in contact with the ribosomes read the RNA and produce proteins from each of these open reading frames, and then those proteins make their way throughout the cell. They initially enter the endoplasmic reticulum, which is a structure involved in transporting proteins throughout the cell. From the endoplasmic reticulum, they're passed on to the Golgi apparatus, which is another set of vesicles which send proteins around the cell, part of the protein transport system. And then from there, the proteins make their way to the proteins and virus particles can make their way to the plasma membrane, where the virus particles can be released from the cell. Now, there's a lot to go through there, given that at this stage on the course, you have not really covered transcription, translation, or cell structure. So for some students, this will be really very tough and maybe blowing your mind at this stage. This is why we've got the live sessions to discuss this in more detail later this week. So the sorts of things that we can discuss in the live session, and I want you to come along with your own questions here, is I want you to look at that viral life cycle and consider everything that you think the virus needs from the host to allow it to replicate in the host cell. So what has the virus got? What has the host cell got? And what is it that the virus needs from the host? And if you can answer that, it will mean you have a fairly full understanding of transcription and translation, but you will be covering this extensively in your CBBM module. Now, what I fully expect is there's going to be concepts in here that you're going to find incredibly difficult at this point. However, when you look back on these lectures, having studied the CBBM module, then elements of this will suddenly become much more understandable. So if you are not following all of this lecture, when you come back to revise this lecture before your exams, hopefully it will make much more sense. Okay, so bring a list of things that you think the virus needs from the host cell. Maybe think about how the virus infects cells. How could this lead to therapies? Superficially, you know, it might give you clues as to what we are working on in terms of therapies. You could also, for discussion, think, what is the point of a virus? Yeah, that's a fairly general question, but why are they there? Why are they so prevalent? Is a virus even alive? That is something that has troubled biologists ever since viruses were first described. Could viruses possibly serve a positive function? And we could also discuss, where do we think the SARS-CoV-2 virus really came from? Although we'll probably cover this in week 5 as well. But for this discussion, bring along anything that you want to discuss. If it's something that I've already got planned for a future lecture, I will mention that. but bring along your questions and bring along your misconceptions, anything that you've not understood so far. Okay, well, I think that's more than enough for your first lecture of your first module of your first course. We are starting this at a very high level because you're going to be hearing so much more about this virus throughout the course of your year. You're going to be learning the basic cell biology in other modules to make this lecture more understandable. And if you don't understand it at the end of this lecture, and even at the end of the discussion, it may well be that something that you learn in CVBM module or one of the other modules will make all of this come together by the end of your first year. So by the time you finish this module, sometimes things that you didn't understand in week 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 will make sense at the end, and that's fully expected. But bring along questions of anything that I've said today that you do not understand, and I will explain it as clearly, and possibly bring in other lecture slides to explain what I mean. Okay, I look forward to seeing you at our live session.